الله والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. On behalf of CIOGC, I'd like to welcome and thank each and every one of you for joining into our weekly Imam Tafsir series. My name is Amir and I currently serve on the board of the Muslim Association of Bolingbrook, along with being a member of Gain Peace. For today's Imam series, we have with us Mawlana Arif Kamal. Mawlana Arif Kamal completed his hifz at the age of 19. And then continued to gain higher education in Islamic studies and graduated 5 years after his hifz with this accreditation. Mawlana Arif has been serving the MAB community in different capacities since this time of hifz, of his higher education completion, and is currently the resident scholar at the Muslim Association of Bolingbrook, along with heading our MAB hifz program, alhamdulillah. He also holds an ijazah in tajweed. He is also an instructor and lecturer of Islamic studies at Darul Qasim in Glendale Heights and leads the recitation ijazah program there as well. Inshallah, today's tafsir series will cover four surahs, Surah Yusuf, Surah Ra'd, Surah Ibrahim, and Surah Hijr. Inshallah, we will have 10 minutes approximately at the end of the program for Q&A. So definitely hold your questions. And with that, Mawlana Arif Kamal.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته إن شاء الله الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين ما بعد so, ما شاء الله as brother Amir mentioned إن شاء الله I will go through with all of you a little bit about Surah Yusuf, Surah Ra'd, Surah Ibrahim and Surah Hijr and so we will إن شاء الله begin with Surah Yusuf. Surah Yusuf ما شاء الله is a very unique surah. And it's a very important surah. It's a surah that we find in the books of tafsir. The mufassirun, the scholars of Qur'an, they spend books and books and length pages talking about this surah because there are so many invaluable lessons that one can get from it. However, what we find in the Qur'an is that Surah Yusuf, as we know, is a surah that has been dedicated to talk about the story of Surah Yusuf, a story of Yusuf alayhi salam. But Surah Yusuf is unique in that regard in the sense that when you look at the Qur'an and when the Qur'an tells us about stories, because we know that the Qur'an tells us about 25 or so, tells us about 25 prophets. But when the Qur'an talks about these prophets, it doesn't give too much detail. Shaykh Waliullah rahimahullah mentions in his Al-Fawz al-Kabir, a book that is an usul tafsir, like the principles that one has to study in order to give tafsir of the Qur'an. So he mentions that when Allah Ta'ala talks about stories in the Qur'an, he doesn't mention too many details because he doesn't want the reciter to be lost in the details. But Allah Ta'ala only tells us what is necessary for us to know, for us to take lessons from, so that we can inculcate it within our life. Now, Surah Yusuf is different in that regard because Allah Ta'ala did not just tell us about details here and there. Allah Ta'ala told us about all of the details of the story of Yusuf alayhi salam. Now, why is that? Why did Allah Ta'ala speak at length about Yusuf alayhi salam? Many of the scholars of Quran, many of the mufassirun, they say the reason why this is because of the fact that when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was in Madinah Munawwara and the Yahud, the Jews, they wanted to test to see if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was actually a prophet. So they asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam some questions. One of the questions that they asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was that if you are truly a prophet, then tell us why Ya'qub alayhi salam moved from Syria to Egypt. And then tell us in detail about what happened with Yusuf alayhi salam. In response to this question, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed Surah Yusuf. So a few details here and there wouldn't have been sufficient to answer the question. Rather, now that the Quran was revealed and it gave all of the details, this is almost a true sign of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, an undeniable sign of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But once they are told these details, they have to accept. And which we find the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam leveled a compelling argument against, and some of them accepted and some of them didn't. But within Surah Yusuf, there are so many lessons. Right? And if we were to truly give all four of these surahs their right, we could speak at length about each surah. An hour or 2 hours will not be sufficient to talk about the lessons that we learned from each of these surahs. But we will endeavor to do whatever we can in the 25 minutes that we have. Now Allah Ta'ala talks about in the beginning of Surah Yusuf, what we find is that Allah Ta'ala is telling us about a very important lesson. Ya'qub alayhi salam, he is informed by Yusuf alayhi salam about a dream that he has. Now this dream that Yusuf alayhi salam has is a blessing, because Allah Ta'ala is giving Yusuf alayhi salam glad tidings in this dream. And Ya'qub alayhi salam, being a prophet himself, recognizes the glad tidings that Yusuf alayhi salam is being given in this dream. But he tells Yusuf alayhi salam to take care of this blessing that Allah Ta'ala has given him. And he says that the way he takes care of it, the way he fulfills its rights, and the way he protects himself, he says, لَا تَقُصُصْ رُؤْيَاكَ عَلَىٰ إِخْوَتِكَ. He says, do not narrate your dream to your brothers. I mean, this is a blessing that you have been given, but I don't want you to convey it to your brothers. And many of the Mufassirun, they mention under this, why? Why did Ya'qub alayhi salam not want Yusuf alayhi salam to mention this dream to his brothers? It was because Yusuf alayhi salam, through this dream, was being given a blessing. And the way that a person is to treat a blessing, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, "Ista'inu ala qada'i hawa'ijikum bil kitman, fa inna kulla dhi ni'matin mahsud." That when you are given certain blessings, don't go out and flaunt them to everyone. Don't go about showing them to everyone, everything that Allah Ta'ala has given you. Why? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, فَإِنَّ كُلَّ ذِي نِعْمَةٍ مَحْسُودٍ. Because every person who possesses a blessing, it's possible that others see them and then become jealous. And jealousy, if a person is jealous of another individual, there can be physical consequences to that. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, إِنَّ الْعَيْنَ حَقٌّ. That the evil eye is true. So if a person wants to protect themselves from the evil eye, one of the things that they have to do is not do anything that will cause another individual to become jealous of them. And why would another individual become jealous? It's because they see you have a blessing that they don't. So the first thing is, the first lesson that we find the Yusuf alayhi salam, the story of Surah Yusuf begins with, is do not go out and tell everyone about the blessings that you have. However, we have to see this ayah, we have to see this concept in the light of another ayah in Surah Duha. Because we find that the Qur'an is completely cohesive with one another. The Qur'an complements one another. Al-Qur'an yufassiru ba'duhu ba'da. The Qur'an explains itself within it. Allah Ta'ala says, وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. As for the blessings that Allah Ta'ala has given you, tell people about them. So how do we understand this lesson that we're learning in Surah Yusuf in light of this ayah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning in Surah Duha? Surah Yusuf, we're learning, don't tell everyone about your blessings. Surah Duha, Allah Ta'ala says, وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. Allah says, your blessings, tell them to people. The Mufassirun, and we find other ayat and other ahadith complement the meanings of these two ayat, but they find a middle ground how we should understand both ayat. This is why we cannot go into just the Quran and read it, or even hadith, and read one hadith and then think we've understood everything that hadith has to tell us regarding the topic that it is discussing. But in order to know the hadith well, we have to know all of the hadith. If we're discussing a topic of hadith, we have to be aware of all of the hadith that discuss that topic. Likewise, Quran. If you want to know about what the Quran is teaching you regarding any topic, you have to look at how have other parts of the Quran discussed this topic. Right? So when we look at the topic of blessings, right, and whether we should share them with one another, we find these two ayat. How do we reconcile the understanding of these two concepts? The scholars say the way you should only tell people about your blessings who are well wishes for you. People who will see that you have these blessings and they will be happy for you. They will make dua for you. They will be happy, they will make dua that Allah Ta'ala increases you. But however, if you're aware that if you tell someone about a blessing that you have, that they may become jealous, that they may not appreciate it, they may not be well-wishers, then this is the advice that Ya'qub alayhi salam was given, which is you don't tell everyone about it. You thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it, you display gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it, but you are not supposed to go out and tell other people about it to protect yourself. And this is the way a person fulfills the rights of that blessing. Furthermore, when it comes to, you know, if you're showing a person a blessing that you have, and even if we find that other people have blessings that we don't, the one way that we do not want to respond is by being jealous. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Iyyakum wal hasad," that be aware of hasad, avoid jealousy. Be aware of jealousy. Because jealousy, if a person is jealous, what will happen is that jealousy will eat a person's good deeds, just like fire eats wood. So Imam Bukhari has a chapter in his book called إِحْبَاطُ عَمَلِ الْمُؤْمِنِ وَهُوَ لَا يَشْعُرُ, that a person's deeds are being nullified and they don't even know it. So Imam Bukhari, under this chapter, he talks about certain spiritual diseases. And one of these diseases that he talks about is jealousy. That if a person, you might be praying your salah, you might be fasting, you might be reading Qur'an, you might be giving sadaqah, but if you have jealousy in your heart towards another individual, then that can cause all of your deeds to become nullified. It can nullify some of your good deeds. Right? So we want to be away from jealousy as far as possible. And Allah Ta'ala says, وَلَا تَتَمَنَّوْ مَا فَضَّلَ اللَّهُ بِهِ بَعْضَكُمْ عَلَى بَعْضٍ. Do not, if you see Allah Ta'ala has given someone a blessing that you don't have, don't be envious of it. Allah Ta'ala is not even talking about jealousy here. Allah Ta'ala is saying, don't even be envious of it. Don't even desire it. If you see that a person has a blessing that you don't have, don't even desire it, because what Allah Ta'ala is destined for you in terms of your sustenance, in terms of your rizq, we are supposed to be content. And that is what will bring about the best results in this life and in the hereafter. So this is the first lesson that we learn from the life of, from the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, that when he first has this dream, his father Yaqub alayhi salam is telling him, do not tell others about it. Now furthermore, when you continue to what happens in the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, again, there are so many details and so many lessons that we can learn, but because I have to cover the other surahs as well, I'm only going to be talking about two or three. Another lesson that we learn is the fact that Yusuf alayhi salam is a prophet. And he knows that the wife of the king of Egypt, right, is after him. He makes a dua to Allah Ta'ala. Now, as a prophet, he's making this dua. He says, وَإِلَّا تَصْرِفْ عَنِّي كَيْدَهُنَّ أَصْبُ إِلَيْهِنَّ وَأَكُمْ مِنَ الْجَاهِلِينَ. He's basically saying, as a prophet, hey Allah, if you don't protect me, it's very possible that I fall into sin and that I become amongst the ignorant. Yusuf alayhi salam as a prophet is saying this. And we know the prophets are all ma'asum. The prophets are all impeccable. They haven't committed sin. And the scholars of Aqidah, they even write in their books that the prophets don't even have the inclination of sin ever come into their heart. So Yusuf alayhi salam, he's never been inclined towards a sin. And he has never performed a sin. But he's still asking Allah Ta'ala to save him from sin. If this is a prophet, then what about you and I? This shows that we should always be making dua to Allah Ta'ala and asking Him to save us from sin, because no one is invincible. No one is, you know, invincible from committing any sin. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, we know he was one of the great companions who heard many hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He would make a dua towards the end of his life. Now just think about this dua. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu would make a dua. He would say, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min an azni wa an a'mala kabiratan fil Islam. This was his dua. This was the dua of Abu Hurairah radhiyallahu anhu when he was older. He would say, oh Allah, I seek your protection from me ever committing zina and from me ever performing any major sin in Islam. Abu Hurairah radhiyallahu anhu, he's so close to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he has done such a great contribution towards hadith. Now when he's older, he doesn't think to himself that, oh, I've done so much, Allah will protect me. No, he continues to make this dua. So what we learn from that, just like Yusuf alayhi salam is making this dua, oh Allah, save me from sin. Just like Ibrahim alayhi salam made the dua, Rabbi habli hukman wa alhiqni bis salihin. He made the dua, wa alhiqni bis salihin. Ibrahim alayhi salam, he's saying, oh Allah, allow me to be with the pious, although he's pious himself. If this is the outlook of a prophet, then what about you and I? We should always be making dua to Allah Ta'ala to protect us from committing sin, because this is a sign of humility. We should always be protecting Allah Ta'ala. We should always be asking Allah Ta'ala to put us in the company of the righteous, so that we may not even be inclined towards sin. This is one of the du'as that Yusuf alayhi salam was making. He said to Allah Ta'ala, you know, these words, and the psychology behind that is such a lesson that we can get from it. That he didn't think of himself. He didn't have an ego. He was a prophet. He had never committed a sin. He had performed so many good deeds, but that still didn't cause him to think, oh, I'm invincible, I'll never perform a sin. No, he recognized, I am completely dependent on the mercy of Allah. I am completely dependent on the mercy of Allah. This attitude, this humility that that Yusuf alayhi salam is displaying is something that we all, inshallah, can take home with from today, inshallah. Now, furthermore, we find, I mean, there's so many lessons. We find in the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, after he was tested, after he was thrown in the well, then he was taken out of the well, right? And after he became the king of Egypt, and now he is put in a position where he's now in the treasurer of Egypt, right? His brothers come to him and they are asking him for help. They throw Yusuf alayhi salam in a well, and Allah Ta'ala tested him at that time. He displayed patience, and at the end of it, now his brothers are coming to him and asking him for help, and they also ask Yusuf alayhi salam to forgive them. What we learn from that is that when a person is tested, the purpose of that is only to raise their ranks. When Yusuf alayhi salam was tested here, when he was in the depths of the well, when he was going through difficulty, he never lost patience. He always had hope in Allah Ta'ala. He knew there was a great plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that there was a reason why Allah Ta'ala was putting him through the difficulties that he was. And at the end of it, because he displayed patience, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised his ranks in this dunya, and also, as we know, of course, in the hereafter. Likewise, we learn from that, especially towards this epidemic that everyone is experiencing, this pandemic that everyone is experiencing. May Allah Ta'ala protect all of us. Some of us are going through difficulties, right? Many of us, if not all of us, are going through difficulties. This is a time that we turn to Surah Yusuf and we try to inculcate this lesson. That just as Yusuf alayhi salam was patient in the time of difficulty, Allah Ta'ala raised his ranks. He elevated his ranks in this life and in the hereafter. Likewise, if a person is going through difficulty and if the person is going through difficulty displays patience, Allah Ta'ala will raise their ranks in this life and in the hereafter. Now lastly, the last lesson I want to share about the story of Yusuf alayhi salam is that Yusuf alayhi salam, at the end of it, after his dream comes to manifestation, and after he is united with his parents, after he is united with his family, when he talks about Allah Ta'ala, he doesn't mention anything negative. He doesn't mention any of the difficulties that he had experienced. He says, وَقَدْ أَحْسَنَ بِي إِذْ أَخْرَجَنِي مِنَ السِّجْنِ وَجَاءَ بِكُم مِّنَ الْبَدْوِ مِنْ بَعْدِ أَن نَزَغَ الشَّيْطَانُ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ إِخْوَتِي. Yusuf alayhi salam is only displaying words of positivity. Yusuf alayhi salam is only displaying words of gratitude, which shows what? That the way that a person remains successful in this life is despite whatever difficulty a person is going through, a person should always remain positive, just as Yusuf alayhi salam was. And even when a person is, inshallah, relieved, and they are now relieved from that difficulty, we should only remember whatever it was that we went through in the most positive of life. And we should never complain to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about those things. Just as Yusuf alayhi salam, he didn't complain to Allah. Likewise, Adam alayhi salam, he didn't complain to Allah. He blamed himself. He didn't complain to Allah. However, Iblis complained to Allah. Iblis blamed Allah. He says, Rabbi bima aghwaytani. Iblis blamed Allah. He said, oh Allah, this because of you, you misguided me. The perspective of the righteous, the perspective of the prophets is never to blame Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but rather it's to remember that in everything Allah Ta'ala has done, that there is a wisdom and there is a hikmah. And in that, inshallah, it will be a result of positivity and something good in this life, and of course, something great that it will await them in the hereafter. These are some of the lessons that we learn from the story of Yusuf alayhi salam. Actually, there was one other lesson that I wanted to share. I wrote it down and I wanted to share it because it's a very important lesson. It's actually relating to parenting. Right? What we find is when the brothers of Yusuf alayhi salam, they go to Ya'qub alayhi salam and they present to him, you know, the false blood. They present to him whatever that they did. And he clearly showed Ya'qub alayhi salam that Yusuf alayhi salam is in difficulty, he's gone, and that my sons betrayed my trust. Now how does Ya'quba alayhi salam respond? Ya'quba alayhi salam responds by saying, فَصَبَرٌ jamil. He says, patience, beautiful patience is what I need to exercise here. What does beautiful patience mean? Beautiful patience means that a person only keeps their expectations with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A person is not looking for empathy from creation. Rather, a person is only expecting blessings from Allah Ta'ala. This is what fasabarun jamil. This is what the concept of fasabarun jamil is. But the lesson we learn is that Ya'qub alayhi salam is a father, and those are his sons. But Yusuf, but Yaqub alayhi salam doesn't go scolding his sons. Why is that? This is because when it comes to parenting, we learned the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he mentioned that there are three stages to a relationship between a father and his children. One of them is when the child is up until 7 years old, the child is a sayyid, the child gets whatever they want. From 7 until they are mature, from 7 until they are mature, the child is to be, that's when the upbringing of the child takes place. This is when the tarbiyah of the child takes place. This is when the father is to instill all the values. This is when the father is to teach the child all the lessons, the father and mother. This is their child, this is their time period of learning lessons from the parents. And after that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, after 14, your job is just, after they become mature, your job is to become their friend. Because by that time, after that, it's only nasiha. That's the, as much as the parents can give. The most they can give is nasiha, because the child is responsible for themselves. The child is responsible for themselves. The parents are not held accountable for them anymore. After that, the children are held accountable for themselves. Yaqub alayhi salam recognizes this. This is why he could have given them advice. He could have scolded them. He could have said so many things to them as his father, as being their father. But he says, فَصَبَرٌ جَمِيلٌ. Because he knows the tarbiyah that he did, well, this is the result. And we know about the brothers of Yusuf alayhi salam, they made this mistake. They made this sin. But many of the scholars of tafsir say the brothers of Yusuf alayhi salam were at the very least awliya of Allah. They're at the very least awliya of Allah. So when it comes to parenting, we learn these are the three relationships that a person should have with a child. In the beginning, the child is a sayyid, they're the master, they control it. They control the show. In the middle, the tarbiyah takes place. And after they're mature, we're supposed to be their friend. We're supposed to give them nasiha, allow them to be, you know, find in us consolement, find in the parents consolement, find in the parents someone that they can come and talk to and get advice from. This is why Yaqub alayhi salam doesn't spend too much time scolding them, because he understands these values. And so those are some of the lessons that we learned from the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, from Surah to Yusuf. Now the next surah is Surah Ra'ad. Surah Ra'ad is a Madani surah. And what we learn in Surah Ra'ad, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about many things. But the primary focus of Surah Ra'ad is the connection between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator, and his creation. Allah Ta'ala talks about the purpose of the sun. Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala talks about the purpose of the moon. Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala even talks about vegetation. Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala talks about his relationship with the non-believers. Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala talks about the relationship that the non-believers have with the believers. And then Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala also talks about the relationship that a believer is supposed to have with Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. And the way Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala describes that, Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala describes the relationship between a believer and his creator by saying, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَتَطْمَئِنُّ قُلُوبُهُمْ بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about how the believer should view remembering their Lord. And Allah ta'ala says, the believer should find absolute contentment in the remembrance of their Lord. That there should be nothing that should bring us the level of contentment that the zikr of Allah does. If something else brings us more contentment than the zikr of Allah, we know there is some self-rectification that needs to take place. Because the way Allah Ta'ala is saying the relationship between the creator and the creation, and more specifically, the believer, the way that relationship is supposed to be, is that the believer finds no source of contentment except in the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, except in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, the example of the one who remembers Allah and the one who doesn't is like the example of the living and the dead. Hadith in Bukhari and Muslim. The Prophet, it's mentioned about Ibn Taymiyyah, and this is mentioned in many, many books. Ibn Taymiyyah would say, the example of dhikr and the heart, the example of remembering Allah and the heart is like that of fish and water. Can the fish live without water? No, if you don't have water, the fish will die. Then continues to say, likewise, if a person doesn't do dhikr, their heart will die. Their spiritual heart will die. What that means is that that contentment that we're supposed to have in dhikr of Allah won't be there. We're going to find contentment in material means. That in a connection that we're supposed to have with Allah Ta'ala won't be there. This is what Allah Ta'ala is focusing on in Surah Ra'ad. And at the end, mainly, in the points that I mentioned, the connection that the believer is supposed to have with their Lord, which is we should find no source of enjoyment, no source of contentment more than remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, when you go on to Surah Ibrahim, now the last two surahs, Surah Ibrahim and Surah Hijr, these both of these surahs are Makki. Now, what it means for a surah to be Makki is basically that it was a surah that was revealed before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made Hijrah. And what we find in the lifetime of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba, the Meccan lifetime, the Meccan period, is that there was technically only one pillar of Islam that was revealed until 6 months before the Hijrah. So for about 12 and a half years, because the Meccan period lasted, according to majority of scholars, for 13 years. For 12 and a half years, the only pillar of Islam that the believers were acting upon was Shahada. Salah was revealed 6 months before the Hijrah, according to the strongest opinion. And all of the surahs that are revealed in Mecca, the Meccan period, this period before Hijrah, was revolving around akhlaq, was revolving around building the character of a believer, connecting a person to their Lord, reminding ourselves of the concept of reward and punishment, attracting our hearts to Jannah, repelling our hearts from Jahannam. This is what the central theme of the Meccan surahs is, to establish Tawheed. Right? This is what we find is taking place also in Surah Ibrahim and Surah Hijr. Surah Ibrahim, Allah Ta'ala mentioned the story of Ibrahim. He also mentioned the story of Musa alayhi salam. Also, Allah Ta'ala also talks about the Kalima. Right? So what we learn from Surah Ibrahim is the foundations of Tawheed. This is what Ibrahim alayhi salam, the story that Allah Ta'ala is mentioning in Surah Ibrahim, is reiterating the foundations of Tawheed. Allah Ta'ala talks about the Kalima, La ilaha illallah, and how the relationship that it has with the believer, and the strength of La ilaha illallah. Then Allah Ta'ala talks about Musa alayhi salam, and the contempt of gratitude. Gratitude is directly related to Tawheed. Gratitude is directly related to a person believing that there is one Allah. Because the more grateful a person is, the more true of a believer they are. Shaytan, when Allah Ta'ala expelled Shaytan from Jannah, when Allah Ta'ala expelled him and sent him to the earth, Shaytan told Allah that I will attack your believers. I will attack your believers. And I have one goal, which is, وَلَا تَجِدُ أَنَّ أَكْثَرَهُمْ شَاكِنْ. Allah Ta'ala, Shaytan said to Allah, that you will see that most of your servants do not display gratitude. This is the sole, one of the sole aspects, of one of the core mission of Shaytan, is to make sure that you and I are not grateful to Allah Ta'ala. So Allah Ta'ala focuses on gratitude. And one of the things that we have to remember about gratitude, one of the blessings of gratitude, is it comes in a hadith, that on the Day of Judgment, there will be a call that is made. And the call that is made, it will be told, oh, those who praised Allah, stand up and enter Jannah. And at that point, a group of believers, a group of people will stand up and they will enter Jannah. And when others will ask, who are these people? Who are the Hammadun? Who are these people who stood up before accounting has even taken place and are entering Jannah? They will be told, الَّذِينَ يَشْكُرُونَ عَلَى كُلِّ حَالٍ. Though it is those people who displayed gratitude to Allah regardless what their condition was. So gratitude is a very important quality, and I ask Allah Ta'ala to give myself, first and foremost, and all of us to inculcate this quality. And the last surah that of these four is Surah Al-Hijr. Surah Al-Hijr, as I mentioned earlier, is also a Meccan surah. Surah Al-Hijr is going over, talking about how creation began. It also talks about the story of Iblis. Allah Ta'ala then talks about the story of Ibrahim. Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala talks about the relationship that the believer should have with Allah Ta'ala. How is our worship supposed to be with Allah Ta'ala? Allah Ta'ala mentions that at the end, and I'll talk about that. But one thing I wanted to mention is Allah Ta'ala mentioned the beginning of Surah Al-Hijr. Allah Ta'ala mentions about the non-believers and what their perspective is in terms of living in this world. And what we learn from that is, if Allah Ta'ala is describing to us what the perspective of the non-believers is, then we learn from that what the perspective of the believer should be. Allah Ta'ala says, ذَرْهُمْ يَأْكُلُوا وَيَتَمَتَّعُوا وَيُلْهِيهِمُ الْأَمَلُ فَسَوْفَ يَعْلَمُونَ. That they spend this life, Allah Ta'ala says, in socialization, in eating and drinking, and they are diverted in false hope. Allah Ta'ala says, فَسَوْفَ يَعْلَمُونَ. They will eventually learn the reality. What we learn from that is the believer is someone who is not to be lost in the dunya. Rather, the prime focus of the believer is to be on the hereafter. The believer is mainly focused on the hereafter and the pleasure of the hereafter while experiencing all the blessings that a person does in this world. When a believer wakes up, he or she is thinking about the good deeds that they can perform this day. When a believer wakes up, we can think about how we can fill our scales in the hereafter. When a believer goes to sleep, we can think about all the opportunities of goodness that we missed. This is the perspective of the believer, right? It comes in a hadith in Muslim and also in the Arba'een of Imam Nawawi that he says, when a person wakes up and you make an intention to do a good deed, if you make a true intention to do a good deed when you wake up and you are able to perform that good deed, then Allah Ta'ala will give you 10 times the reward. However, if you make an intention to do a good deed and you're not able to do it, but because you had that intention, Allah Ta'ala will still give you the reward of it. Allahu Akbar. So how many of us cannot make an intention? But this is what the perspective Allah Ta'ala is saying in the beginning of Surah Al-Hijr is of the believer. And at the end, Allah Ta'ala ends by saying, وَعْبُدَ رَبَّكَ حَتَّى يَأْتِيَكَ الْيَقِينَ. That you should never stop worshiping your Lord until certainty comes to you. And this command is actually to the Prophet ﷺ, but by way of commanding the Prophet ﷺ, Allah Ta'ala is also commanding the entire ummah, which is we are to worship Allah until certainty comes to us. And what is the meaning of certainty? Death. So Allah Ta'ala is saying, continue to worship Allah, continue to strive in obeying Him until death comes to us. May Allah Ta'ala protect us. May Allah Ta'ala, you know, allow us to inculcate all these lessons. May Allah Ta'ala allow us to become closer to the Qur'an. May Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala allow us to do that which is most pleasing to Him. Ameen wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Jazakumullahu khairan.
MashaAllah, amazing lessons that we can apply, especially with the pandemic situation that looms over us. And Mawlana Arif, you covered some amazing points about the parents and the parenting side of things. And I personally feel, being a dad myself, and many of us who are parents, we don't have that formula down, the 7-7-7 rule that you gave us, 0 to 7, plant the seeds, 7 to 14 or maturity. That's when the real discipline takes place. And subhanAllah, I think that the main crisis right now with us parents is that we are missing that formula. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, can you just highlight that one more time for us? Yes. For any viewer that joined late, subhanAllah, I would suggest everybody to write this down, frame it on your fridge. I'm going to do the same, inshallah.
All right. So, I mean, it was going over the lessons of Surah to Yusuf, and how Ya'qub alayhi salam didn't scold his sons once they did what they had done. And this is because we have a formula of the Prophet ﷺ in regards to what the relationship between a son and their parents are supposed to be. He says, from the time they are born until 7, the child is a Sayyid, which means they get whatever they want. They are a Sayyid. Then from 7 until maturity, this is the time where we are to do their upbringing. We are to do their tarbiyah. This is why within this time period at 10, the Prophet ﷺ said, if they're not praying, then you can, you know, take physical action. Because it's in that time period of 7 and maturity where they are to be taught their values. Right? So from 7 until they're mature is when the parents have to work hard in teaching and instilling within their children the correct values as human beings, moral values, and of course, Islamic values. And then after that, the Prophet ﷺ says when the child is mature, and from after that, the relationship that a parent is supposed to have with their child is to be an advisor. Was it to be an advisor? Because that's what a parent can do at that time. You can advise and give nasiha. You are to be a friend with your child so that they can come to you, they can feel comfortable in opening up to you, they can look to you for advice, they can see you as a role model. This is how the Prophet ﷺ mentioned in the hadith that the relationship between a father and child is to be.
If we were flooded with a lot of questions around respect to our elders, the Western world that we live in, the influence, kids tending to be rude. And I think that if all of us parents can apply that simple formula, inshallah ta'ala, that will really, really help us. And subhanAllah, we're reading in the news that during this shelter in place and during this lockdown, that cases of emotional and physical abuse are on the rise, subhanAllah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from these and keep us away from the whispers of shaitan, inshallah.
Amen, amen.
Please go ahead.
Sorry, go ahead.
No, I was going to just go to the next question, but before we do that, I'll let you close out that point, inshallah, that you were going to.
No, that was it. That was it. I'm waiting for the question.
Okay, so questions coming in. How would you advise us? I'm going to skip that. We already answered all the kids and the parenting questions. I think Mawlana Arif covered that beautifully. How can we show gratitude and at the same time express our dire and urgent need in dua?
Right. So the main thing about gratitude is gratitude, again, is a state of the heart. And the way that we show gratitude is by not complaining to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not basically saying anything negative, right? That's the essence of gratitude, to accept, to be content with it, whatever Allah ta'ala has decreed for us, right? That's the essence of gratitude. Now, of course, when a person is making dua, you are to pour your heart out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we find in the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that you make dua, you ask Allah ta'ala to fulfill all of your needs. You ask Allah Ta'ala to make it easy for you. You ask Allah to make you stronger. Right? And you ask Allah Ta'ala to facilitate barakah and your rizq, so on and so forth. So in dua, you ask everything that you can. And the Sahaba, the Prophet would say, the Prophet would tell the Sahaba, ask everything that you can. The Sahaba said, okay, then we're going to ask. The Prophet said, Allah can give more even than what you ask. So we are to ask. But the way that we display gratitude in making dua is it's a state of the heart, by being content. And then asking Allah Ta'ala for everything that we want and we can have.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, subhanAllah, you also covered the beautiful balance between Surah Yusuf's nasiha and Surah Duha's nasiha about sharing compliments with one another. And really, there's just so much immediate click and posting on social media that I personally feel it's tearing up homes because of the evil eye. So one of the questions that came in are, what are practices or du'as to protect us from those evil eye, and also right. just highlighting that balance of knowing your well-wishers, who to share, what you share with.
Right,
and
right.
not every news is for everybody. Keeping in mind the beautiful lessons of Surah Yusuf about his father's nasihat to his kids.
So in general, when it comes to sharing news, good news that you have, if you're not sure, you shouldn't share it. Right? So of course, if you know that a person is well-wisher, they're open with you, they're sharing their good news with you, and therefore they'll appreciate it if you share good news with them. And that's how you know, of course, you'll know through your relationship with them. If you are not very open with an individual, you don't know how they will take it, and the perspective is to basically you shouldn't share it to protect yourself. Now, when it comes to protecting oneself from evil eye, of course, the first result is dua. The second result, though, the second way a person protects himself from the evil eye, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned many different ways a person can take precaution, such as reciting the last two verses of Surah Al-Baqarah before going to sleep, such as reciting Surah Al-Ikhlas, Surah Al-Falaq, and Surah Al-Nas after Fajr and Maghrib Salah, reciting these three times, reciting those surahs three times. Also, the Prophet ﷺ taught, this was a little bit of a longer narration, but if you say, like, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ السَّمِيعِ الْعَلِيمِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ, so if you say, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ with السَّمِيعِ الْعَلِيمِ in between three times, and then you recite the last three verses of Surah Al-Hashr, and you do this after Fajr and Maghrib, then Allah Ta'ala will send 70,000 angels to your protection. So if you do it after Fajr, that Allah Ta'ala appoints 70,000 angels to protect you until Maghrib. And if you do it after Maghrib, then Allah Ta'ala appoints 70,000 angels to protect you until Fajr. So these are certain ways we can take the Qur'anic remedies as a means of protection, as the Prophet ﷺ has taught.
Jazakallah khair. And I think those were quite a bit of du'as that Mawlana right. Arif just covered. And I think we can share that with CIOGC. If anyone is interested in getting that, alhamdulillah, Mawlana Arif had that published in our community in Bolingbrook, and we have that handy. So we'll share it with the CIOGC administration team if anyone would like a copy of those du'as that Mawlana Arif just covered for protection from the evil eye. Inshallah, you can have those. And we have one more question here. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses one with wealth At times we can be anonymous when making donations, or at times we want to publicize it to others so that they get inspired and the donations kind of pour in as a result of that. And we see that in benefit dinners and fundraising dinners where the announcement is made of who the top initial donor was. So can you elaborate on this point just a little bit?
Allah Ta'ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, إِن تُبَدُوا الصَّدَقَاتِ فَنِعِمَّاهِ. Then whoever, if you make your sadaqah apparent, then it's great. وَإِن تُخْفُوهَا وَتُؤْتُوهَا الْفُقَرَاءَ فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. And if you conceal it, then it's also good for you. So the idea is that if you're doing it by way of encouraging, and your intention is correct, right? You're only doing it to encourage, then inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, will use that as use you as a means of encouraging others, and inshallah, you will get the reward as well. So it goes down to the, it's about the intention, inshallah, and if your intention is correct, Allah ta'ala, inshallah, will protect you. So that's, if you want to give sadaqah by way of encouraging, then you can do that. And inshallah, Allah ta'ala will protect you from the evil eye, inshallah. We have to also be positive-minded when it comes to these things. We can't, there's also a balance, like we can't all of a sudden become like very scared or anything like this. We also have to be, you know, positive thinking that my intention was correct. Allah Ta'ala is going to protect us. Right? There are many stories like this of the awliya. So I understand your the question that you feel that if you say your name and other people hear it, they may get jealous. Well, if it's by way of encouraging, if it's by way of encouragement, and your intention is correct, inshallah, Allah Ta'ala will protect you. But if you are overly, you know, if you're not sure, you there's a certain audience there that you know might not be able to handle it, take it well, then of course, at that point, you can say it anonymously.
Ameen. No, innama al-a'malu bin-niyat, right? Yeah. So it is really all about the intention, subhanAllah. So alhamdulillah, jazakallah khair. I think that's a wrap. So barakallah fi for an amazing Imam series. This program is brought to you by Council of Islamic Organizations of Greater Chicago. We thank our co-host, Downtown Islamic Center, and our sponsor, Dr. Muzaffar Mirza and Associates. Please remember CIOGC in your donations and donate at ciogc.org/donate. Inshallah, tomorrow we have Sheikh Hassan Ali of Mecca Center giving an abridged tafsir on Surah Nahl, Surah Al-Isra, Surah Al-Kahf, inshallah. Thank you for watching. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward all of us strength, courage, and grant us all good deeds. We ask all of you to make dua for all of us, inshallah ta'ala, for the entire ummah, especially in the countdown here to iftar time, inshallah. Jazakallah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.